I think it'd be a great time to transition to our Ask Google segment.
Let's see. Why do Christians worship on Sunday?
So Christians worship on Sunday kind of for two reasons. Number one, Saturday was taken by the Jewish tradition of the Sabbath beginning at sundown on Friday and moving all through Saturday. The early followers of Jesus were Jewish, and so they already were spending that entire day in rest and in study. And so it really wasn't available to be a time of gathering. But then secondly, the story of Jesus' resurrection pinpoints that event to a Sunday morning. Basically, the sun goes down on Saturday night, it's dark. The first time there's light next would be Sunday morning. That's when the women went to the tomb. That's when they find it empty. They tell the story of Jesus' resurrection. They gather in the upper room and share that story with one another. And then that becomes the pattern for gathering. So early on, I think the Christians probably honored both days. They would gather in the Jewish traditions on a Saturday and then would gather again on a Sunday. And then in time, as a way to distinguish them, they settled on the Sunday. And when the Romans came in and Christianity became an official religion, that's when that became the first day of the week and changed our calendars a bit.
Here's another one that you sort of already answered. Why do Christians believe in the Trinity?
When God wants to tell us an important thing, God uses a two-part answer. When God wants to tell us a really complicated answer, God uses a three-part answer. So two-part answers are Jesus is fully human, fully divine. Jesus lived once, and yet he died and rose again. But a three-part answer reflects a richness that is deeper than the usual things that we deal with in life. So we are used to dealing with opposites, black and white, fast and slow, young and old. But the Trinity and the three-part answer is a rich way to describe the quality of God's love. That love is something that pre-exists us, in terms of the beginning of time, a creation. That love is something that's intentional and directed to us in the form of an individual in history. And that love is ongoing and moves towards the future in terms of a spirit that is not constrained to one period, but is there for eternity. So those three ideas held together in a creative tension form the heart of the Trinity and the Christian doctrine.
So this is one of those funny ones because you're not really going to know what this person or whoever was Googling this means, but why do Christians believe in Mary?
Well, I can see where the question comes from because there are parts of the Christian church that are very reverential, fond of Mary, Jesus' mother. And there are other parts of the Christian church that don't emphasize her role. So the short answer is that Mary is honored as the mother of Jesus, the woman who literally was greeted by an angel, had a child, our belief says miraculously, and gave birth to that child who our belief also says was the Son of God, had the attributes and the fullness of God. So Mary, in that sense, is very special, the mother of God, in effect. On a more personal or human level, for a long time, the church had trouble talking to God. They felt God was simply too distant. And even for a while, Jesus wasn't a very sympathetic conversation partner. Jesus was seen as the judge, the one that would separate the good from the bad. And so during the times of the Middle Ages and a little before, Mary became a figure that people felt, I can talk to her. She knows what it's like to be a mother. She knows what it's like to struggle. She knows what it's like to be alone and afraid. And so I will pray to her that she will intercede with her son and that hopefully between the two of them, they'll get a good word in with God. And so the veneration of Mary started in the Middle Ages and had many expressions in the Catholic Church. But at its heart, it's simply acknowledging that Jesus' mother was pretty special.
So that's really interesting because that's where your mind went. I actually went to Mary Magdalene, who was the one that witnessed, was the first person, and correct me if I'm wrong, the first person that witnessed the resurrection of Jesus, and everybody's, oh, she's a woman. And that's where my mind went. So that, because in that time period, it was, I guess, seen at more as a woman's word wasn't as strong as a man's.
Right.
So that's kind of where my mind went.
So yeah, Mary Magdalene, there is a gospel attributed to her in the Gnostic Gospels. There is a veneration and an honoring of her. But I think it's a sad reality that women voices, particularly from that period, but even for much longer, were not honored. Mm-hmm. And so if you know any women from the Bible, it's because they are the exceptions and they've stood out so much that they couldn't be ignored. Mm-hmm. But that doesn't mean that people didn't try to ignore them or downplay them through the centuries.
Right. Well, thank you very much. I really appreciate you coming on today and talking to me about Christianity.
Yeah, it's been my pleasure. It's been a lot of fun, and I wish you well as you continue to ask questions and prod people to think deeper in their own life and faith.
During our interview, Reverend Bush offered this piece of advice.
When I'm often asked questions by people, when I get the phone calls, mm-hmm. as I said to you, mm-hmm. People often approach me or approach the church with a mind already made up. Mm. Either they've seen church and decided it's not for them, for whatever reason, or they've heard of church and they've decided that, no, there's a backwardness there. There's a fearfulness or a rigidity that doesn't feel like it would be a comfortable fit. What I would say is I've been a minister and ordained for over 30 years, and I've spent my life working through the pages of the scripture, and I have yet to be bored. I have yet to find in that single-minded pursuit of asking questions of a particular set of writings, I've yet to find that I've asked every question and I'm done. Now, it doesn't mean that is only a Christian experience. So I would call people to seek, back to your first point, mm-hmm. To build on a faith trust through an active engagement with the belief, to treat it as both a friend and a nemesis, as that which challenges you, but also has a chance to educate and enliven you. And by that pursuit, you can grow into a fullness that I would profess is our approximation of God's love within us. Plato said, the unexamined life is not worth living. The unexamined faith is not worth professing.
As Reverend Bush noted, asking questions, studying, and learning is not just for Christians, it's for everyone, no matter your religion or your culture. I encourage you to educate yourself further, critically think about what you're learning, and ask questions, whether it's through this podcast or other credible sources. I hope you enjoyed the episode and learned something new. If you did, please rate, comment, and subscribe. Until next time.